Hello, SIGGRAPH 2019. We are Digital Domain, and we would love to talk to you about building a real-time digital human framework for live events. First off, new technology requires frameworks. On the left here, you can definitely see our autonomous camera framework. We use that TED 2019. And on the right here, we use our end character system where we can have more than one character in the scene that we use that SIGGRAPH 2019 real-time live. So first off, before I go into more details, I'd like to talk to you about Digital Domain. We are a visual effects company that worked on film and commercials, and also digital human real time. We worked on Digital Domain has worked on films such as Avengers Infinity War, and as well as Ready Player One. So who are we? My name is Chad Reddick.
Jason.
And we are senior Unreal engineers at Digital Domain at the Digital Human Group.
All right, about Digital Human Group. So what we do is we work on trying to make the most realistic digital humans that we can possibly imagine. This involves the best skin that we can come up with, the best facial movements, and hair. But what contains a digital human?
A high-quality 3D model, the movement of the digital human, and of course, the facial movement of the digital human.
But what about the details?
So the details, we need to have the blood flow, which gives you that real-looking kind of blood movement in your face. We need good lighting on the digital human, give the realistic look on the specularity and everything else. And of course, shader complexity, which there's much nested things that have to go into a digital human to make it look realistic. And of course, here is the result. We have Doug here, DigiDoug. Smiling, waving, saying hi to you guys.
So at this point, our framework is just one character at a time. It's non-networked, and it's either flat or VR only.
So let's talk about Ted's live event. One day, Doug comes into the loft. He says, "We got invited to TED." And we were super excited to hear about that. This would be the first live drive of DigiDoug and Elbor. We were really excited to have this. So then, we got the features requested. It was about 3 weeks for when TED was live, about 2 weeks of development time. We had to build autonomous cameras and user cameras, autonomous lighting to properly light DigiDoug and Elbor in runtime. So this required a new framework. We had to create a modular way to create cameras with autonomous options, meaning where it kind of like an AI where it creates a perfect view of the character but without anybody using it. Same thing with the lighting rigs. We had to make sure when the character was moving around, we had to make sure the lighting was always perfect. So we wanted to use an approach of using IOC, which is inversion of control. So then from the top level to the bottom level, everything was initialized, everything had a context, and everything we wanted really fast. And it also needed a name. So we called it the Director Framework. So this is a little bit complex. So we have the Director, which contains all the scenes to view and also the master input. So whatever the director said is as if we're, hey, I want you to change this shot here. That's kind of the concept of using the input. And also always had all of the views that the director knew what shots we were going to be taking. So let's talk about the scenes. The scenes contain the character, camera, and lighting rules for references. So what does this mean? So this means that the we need to know what character we're looking at, the camera type we're using, if it's going to be autonomous, going to be user-based, or is it going to be static. Same thing with the lighting rules as well. Is it going to be following the character? Is it just going to be static throughout the whole scene? Or is it going to have a light that you're going to be able to pivot around to it? And then we're going to talk about another bit of meat and potatoes, which is a camera scene actor. This contained all the autonomous user and static options. So it was able to understand that if you wanted to view a character, it had to do specific kind of ways to look at it and give it the perfect view. So if the character was out of view from this side, it would go back over here. They also have user options, which is like be able to move up and down, left and right, using the mouse wheel, using the mouse up and down, anything else you wanted. Or, of course, a static option, where it'd just be a standstill camera. It would not move, not look, or pivot. It would just be standing there. And the lighting scene actor was autonomous or static. So autonomous meaning it would follow the person around like this, be able to keep the lighting in frame, or you have it just be throughout the whole scene. It would just stay there, and you could walk out of the lighting if you wanted to. So here is the result. So we have the left here is Doug, and the right would be Elbor. So you see how, if you watch here, you see how the camera kind of tries to go over and watch over to keep that same frame shot of you whenever Doug or Elbor moves around. And the cameras are able to switch at runtime. So we had a great success. The framework added to the bigger picture. We're able to make a framework that we could able to use, reuse at any time. Reliable usability, meaning that it was very structured to an extent we could build even further on top of it. It was also very artistic friendly. It didn't require any code to the artist or the kind of like the compositor sort of way to get a good perfect shot.
So at this point, we knew we had SIGGRAPH coming out. So we had the idea of what if we had two DigiDugs? And what if they could both see into virtual reality? And while we're at it, why not throw in ray tracing? So the issues with our current framework at this point was hardware limitations. Ray tracing's not cheap. And we're about to throw a second character in there. Our characters have a lot of geometry. I think we're talking about like 2 something million.
About 2.5 million, I think.
2.5 million verts per character. So we're going to do all that ray tracing. And at this point, we want to drive everything from the VR headset. Next, we're not networked yet. Sorry, go back. We're not networked yet. So we need to implement all of our system into a replication system. And we need to actually implement the view into VR, that is how the characters can see into their virtual environment. And our previous system that Chad talked about only considers one character. It does not consider multiple characters. So we have to now implement that into the old system. So this new system, called the in-character system, we can drive multiple characters. We weren't planning on doing 25, but I thought, why not? Let's try it. But yeah, the features about this are namely the mimic in the VR view. We will talk about those in a moment. And agnostic hosting. This allows any pawn to be, or any player for that matter, to be either a host or a client. And we needed a way to replicate the skeletal transforms because this is not natively supported in Unreal.
Correct.
So the mimic. The mimic, as the name suggests, is a pawn that mimics other pawns. In this video here, on the left you can see the VR view. That's what we're seeing from the VR headset. And on the right is the mimic. So they're pretty close. However, there are some differences, namely the post-processing here. We are able to add depth of field, live color grading, and we're smoothing out the camera. There's many other features we can add to that, but this is what we use for SIGGRAPH. Also, a really important thing is that it saved us a ton of performance. Instead of rendering everything from the VR headset, we copied all the transforms from the cameras of the VR headset over to this new pawn, and so this pawn just rendered out from that location. And this one's my favorite, the view into VR. This is how our actors are able to see into their virtual environment. They're able to make eye contact with each other, and they're able to see the camera and other objects in their world. This changes with the size of the characters. They can see themselves. It's amazing. It adds so much immersion for the conversations that you have with the digital humans.
Especially eye contact's really interesting when you're in VR watching that. It's very uncanny.
All right, so one of the issues that we had is replicating live drive skeleton. This was not natively supported in Unreal. So we needed a way to go about this. What we did was we took two animations, one on the host and one on the client. The host side takes the data from the Xsens, sends it into iKinema to do all the IK solving.
Yep.
And then this, with a little bit of extra magic, turns into our animation of our digital human. However, we still need to capture this final pose. So we made a custom node that grabbed all that data at that point and replicated it down to the clients. The client animation is essentially just a passive animation that waits for new data and says, hey, do I have new bone transforms? Once these bone transforms come in, it says, all right, let's set this skeleton. And now we are able to do this. So this slide might be a little confusing. Feel free to take an image or take a picture of this and ask us any questions afterwards. But to quickly go after it, we have two actors on here, Doug and Kenzie at the top. The green nodes indicate where raw information is taken from the actors. So the top center one, that's emotion tracking. That's the body animations. And then the other two, the neural network one and two, that's where the face data is captured. That information is all sent down to the host computer, where the host figures out how to use this information, sends it into Unreal, and then sends it back out to the other Unreal clients. So, are we able to add more Dougs? We absolutely are, but there is a cost. More Dougs means more machines. Every new actor will need a new suit, a PC, and an HMC to capture their face. All machines need to be networked together. It doesn't need to be local. It can be online. And generally speaking, what we try to do is what we show the audience is the host. The host has the highest quality, and everything else, since it's not as important, is lower quality to save performance. So here's a short video of our real fake Dougs. And so you can see them switching between characters, looking at each other, and they can see the objects that appear in their environment.
So what's next? Host migration. So in our current framework right now, if the host goes down or dies, the rest goes down. So we want to be able to implement a new feature where if the host goes down, the next client will be the next up to be the new host. Also, physical virtual cameras. Instead of being able to have just using a mouse or a keyboard, you want to be able to have a physical camera where you have real human motion, where we have be able to record our virtual cameras. Of course, more smarter AI camera actors. We want to be able to have even more realistic human motion with our camera actors instead of being able to be able to interpolate. It's almost like a robotic way. We'll make sure it feels more human.
And character eye improvements. Right now, we're looking at the actors will look at a flat screen, meaning they their eyes converge on that screen. That's not realistically how we look at things. So we need to figure out a way to be able to look at, to know what the actor's looking at and converge the eyes on that object.
Of course, we want to record live drive data at runtime. What this means is we want to be able to record any sort of motion data, facial data, at runtime with a package build. Say if we're running something on, we have a perfect cool pose, be like, hey, we want to go back and record that while they're running in the EXE. I want to say thank you all for coming. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask us after this presentation. And I hope you enjoy the dancing elbows. Thank you very much.